Today we have Peter Smith from New South Wales DPI demonstrating the irrigation hydraulic model. This demonstration shows the effects that different size pipes and their placement have on flow rate and pressure requirements that are necessary for the irrigation system to operate.
I need someone with some good eyes to come up and have a little measure here. Volunteer? Here we go, here's me. What's the difference between that water level and that water level?
30 mil.
30 mil. So guys, that's head, okay? What's happened is if I take that out of there, that all goes level, or pretty well level. There is a bit of a slope because it's draining out there. That's at the same, more or less the same level. When we put that pipe in there, all the water's got to go through the pipe. You can see it backs up. And in this case, when it settles down, requiring 30 millimetres of head, which is force or pressure, to get the water through that pipe. It didn't need to do that before, but now it does. As I said down the field, there's friction loss going into that pipe, friction loss going through it, and friction loss coming out the end. If I turn, hopefully this will work, the heights weren't quite right yesterday, but if that pipe was fully submerged, if I do it this way around, hopefully it won't stop, that's what it did yesterday. I need a reader, again, someone else. Brad, oh, there we go. What have we got now?
60 mil.
It was 30 mil a minute ago. The difference here, this end's not submerged. So it's doubled the head required. So it's doubled the head loss, the energy required to push it through because that's not submerged. There's a little bit extra going on here. Only a little bit. There's almost a little bit of air getting sucked in there, which messes up a touch. Nothing you can see. So the difference between being the end submerged and not submerged is about double the head in this case. We saw that when we did that with the siphon flows that Janelle was talking about, it'll make that sort of difference to your siphon flow. Really effective. Now this was 30 mil difference. If I talked about size, this one's bigger diameter than this one. We pop it, same length, and you set the same height and all the rest. Need our eyes again. Who wants to come up?
15.
You can see already, can you? 15. So this one was 30. This one, which is not that much bigger in diameter, is 15. It's about half. Anyone got an idea as to why?
Friction.
Less friction. Why?
Greater
cross-sectional area. Yep. What's happening is this. Forcing the water through this one, it's got to go through at a certain speed. And that's creating a certain level of friction. As soon as we open it up, make it a bit bigger, the water doesn't have to go as fast through the pipe, which means there's less friction as it's rolling along the edges of the pipe. So that's the difference of a bit of size and a bit of velocity, a bit of speed in the water. You don't want the water to be too fast because it creates lots of friction. You don't want it to be super slow because otherwise it will allow silt and stuff to fall where maybe you don't want it to fall. It needs more pressure to get it through, but if you actually have this in your channel series down the paddock, all it's doing is effectively, this is your head ditch or your supply channel. You can only get that supply to a certain point, and that means it's pushing, dropping that one lower. It requires more pressure to get through, but the consequence is you end up with a lower head in this channel, which might be your head ditch, and then you can't get your siphon through it properly. Okay? Yeah. If you had a pump, if it was a pump pressure-driven system, you'd have to put more pressure in on the pump to get it to go through there, and that would create more cost in energy. We'll go one smaller, it's a really tiny one, same length. Line up a bit. Okay, who wants to tell me what the difference is of that one? Who can read it? 50 mil. So when we had the one a bit above, it was 30, and this has gone to 50, hasn't doubled it. What direction is going to happen with this one? Two of those, it is. See what sort of difference we get. That's just about settled now. What is it? About 15 to 20. So this was what, 50? Let's drop to the heat. Obviously what we've done is we've doubled the cross-sectional area because we put two pipes in. So whatever speed it was doing through here, it's now doing half the speed through two of them. If you had a, say you had a road crossing or something out there and you wanted to make enough room for the water to get through easily, but if you put in a really big culvert, it was going to create another problem, you might put two smaller ones and increase your cross-section area that way.
How did it compare to one large diameter?
The one next step up was the large 50, one. Wasn't it? So yeah, you're talking about the little one?
Yeah, compared to the large diameter pipe versus
yes.
Two smaller.
What did we have for this one, guys? I can remember.
15.
15, and what have we got here?
Very similar.
Very similar. It's not that it should be. See how this is not exactly double the size, but increasing the diameter increases the cross-sectional area more than just the little bit of size. It's not proportional to just say, oh, if we made it a half diameter bigger, it increases the flow, not by a half, but by a half to the square, I think. That doesn't come out the right way around if you do a half to the square, but it comes out much more. So this is a more efficient way of getting better flow rate through the culvert than using another size pipe. But if you've got no option, using another pipe, if you've got no option, you might have to do that. Here's it, not the really tiny one, but the same as our second one. And it's three times as long. Who can remember what that one, what that size was? When we did that one.
30.
What have we got now? What is it? A little bit more. The key thing to show there is length does increase the friction loss, does require a little bit more head, but it's only a little bit more head relative to the, well, particularly that exit loss that we saw. That just was so much more at the sky height. If we try a wing wall, this is the same size as this bloke again. Same diameter, same length. We've got a wing wall. So we said he was 30. That's just about stabilised. What's that one saying?
About 25.
Just having a wing wall reduces the friction at the inlet of the pipe because it's making it go in like a funnel. Effectively, all the water molecules, instead of having to bump against the wall and churn around and go in the pipe, they're being guided in a lot more smoothly. So that reduces the friction of the water molecules, reduces the friction loss, and you've got less head drop to get it through the pipe. There's a lot of pump sites where people have to do some interesting plumbing and they don't think it's going to matter, but it actually does. And what it's ending up, this is the way to get the message home. It's increased pressure. Every time you're increasing the pressure, it costs more to run the jolly thing. Smoke going up the stack for no gain. One thing I didn't point out down the field there, which I'll just mention here, is that you need to have freeboard on those channels. We saw that where that water level was. I don't know whether it was actually at its operating level, but it was below the top of the actual bank. And you might think, well, why don't you fill it further? And I've seen guys who want to run their channels, you know, right up on the brink. The problem with that is you need to have freeboard to allow for variations of flow, because you get a surge, or for wind that might effectively move the water up one end or the other, and it'll overtop, and then you've got water going out of the channel. the water's going out of the channel, it's not going where you want it to go, so you're losing it, plus it runs the risk of eroding the channel and ruining it, and you've got to put some maintenance in. You need that freeboard basically to give you a bit of buffer, and normally a minimum is 0.15 mm, 150 mils, sort of 6 inch is a minimum of what you'd want. So if you're ever wondering why is that channel like that and they don't run it up to the brim, it's because you need that bit of freeboard just to allow for buffer and also to maintain the integrity of the channel as it's constructed. I mentioned before that a siphon is just like any of these pipes, the same effects happen. With the siphons, things that can mess up the entry and exit losses a bit is how cleanly cut they are. If you go and get a siphon and you hack it off with a bit of a blunt hacksaw or something, got a lot of burrs in there, that's going to create more friction loss at the entry point and the exit point, so you're going to slow down the flow through the siphon. So it's good to have all that pretty clean. The siphon that Janelle's got in the back of the ute, it's got a kink in it, because that's the only way to get in the back of the ute. A kink is effectively reducing the cross-sectional area of the siphon. That will restrict its flow too. And if the siphon is sort of buried a bit, you know, it's nice to have it submerged, but if you've got it buried in the mud, then you're going to be restricting the entry or the exit, depending on which end it's buried in. All those things need care to have the siphon flowing properly, and to they all need to be the same along the whatever the head that's used, so they're all flowing evenly.